In any computer program, bad things can happen despite our awesome code. Bad things can be like errors trying to access an element in an array that doesn't exist, or dividing a number by zero. These failure events are called Java exceptions. An exception in Java is an unexpected event that happens and the program can't continue normal behavior until the problem's addressed. These exception events are something that shouldn't, but in rare cases do happen. When an exception does happen, we say the exception is thrown. We can also provide code to run if an exception happens. This is called catching the exception. When we catch a thrown exception, we're telling Java our catch block code makes everything better and handles the problem gracefully. Catching exceptions gives our program a chance to recover from a problem and continue normal execution. All exceptions are represented with a class that are subtypes of the Java Lang exception class. Exceptions are also subtypes of throwable. Throwable is a superclass for all types of errors and includes the error class. The error class represents something that we can't do anything about. An example is the JVM ran out of memory. In this video, we're going to look at exceptions only, not the errors. There are two types of exceptions, runtime exceptions and checked exceptions. Runtime exceptions are exceptions that we should have prevented. We should never use a variable before it's assigned, so we should never get a null pointer exception. We should iterate over arrays, so we should never get an array index out of bounds exception. These are problems we should prevent using solid programming practices. Java will not force us to provide code to run if a runtime exception is thrown. Instead, the program is just going to crash. Checked exceptions are different. Java forces us to deal with these exceptional conditions. These are unlikely things that could happen in our application no matter what we do. An example is file not found exception. We could write everything perfectly, but someone might delete the file when we're not looking. Java asks us to provide code to catch this exception when it's thrown. We'll cover how to catch exceptions soon. For now, let's look at exceptions and how we trace them back to the problem. Let's create an array with three numbers, but try to print out four. This creates the runtime exception, Java Lang array index out of bounds exception. In this code, we're forcing the error as an example. We know this isn't how we should iterate over an array. When Java hits this error, it throws an exception and exits the program. Now this is a very simple stack trace. It states the runtime exception, in this case, array index out of bounds exception. It also tells us the index this exception happened. So in this case, 3. The only way we can tell this is really from experience and knowing the exception message. We'll look at other exception messages in the next video. The stack trace tells us the line our code where things went bad. That's where it says at DGU com constructors new main class, and the line number is 20. If we go back to our code, we can find line 20. Reading the stack trace for this case, we can see the exception, the bad value, and the line number. That should be enough to pinpoint the error. We can make our call stack deeper by moving the error method to a method outside the main method. Now the stack trace is deeper by one. As we call methods within methods, the stack trace will grow deeper. For some Java programs, this stack trace can be very deep. It really depends where in our program we are. Not all stack traces are as kind as our simple one. Some look like this. Now the cause by area tells us the exception we received above was really caused by this exception. We want to look at this line of code to solve the problem. You can have multiple cause by sections in a stack trace, but the last one will likely be your problem. In this long example, the final exception isn't even in our code. What we want to do in this case is look for the last stack trace message that's coming from our code. The first line that references our code is likely the problem.
Our next question is, how do we handle checked exceptions? I say checked exceptions because we rarely, if ever, try to catch runtime exceptions. If we're trying to catch a runtime exception, we really need to stop and think about what we're trying to accomplish. However, Java does force us to handle all checked exceptions. In Java, we can either catch checked exceptions using something called a try-catch block in code, or specify a requirement that any method calling our method must handle this exception.
If our method has a possibility of throwing an exception, we can specify the exception in the method declaration. We add the keyword throws and the exception class. We only need to do this for checked exceptions. Runtime exceptions do not need to be declared. When we add this code, we're telling anyone calling our method they need to catch this exception.
Exceptions work like this. The exception is thrown in a method somewhere in our code. If we don't catch the exception in this method, we declare our method throws the exception and Java passes the exception up to the calling method. If there's code to catch the exception here, it will run the handling code. Otherwise, it'll keep working its way up the call stack until it reaches the main method, or a method that does catch the exception. If nothing catches the exception, the program crashes and reports the problem. So how do we catch an exception? We use a try-catch block. It starts with a keyword try, a code block to try, and then the keyword catch, the exception type, and the code to handle the exception. This code says, try this code block, and if there's an exception of this type, catch it with this code block. Once the exception is caught, we execute the next line of code after the catch. The exception type is important. Our catch block applies only for the exception type we state after the catch keyword. So if we put file not found exception, it will only apply for file not found exceptions and any possible file not found exception subclasses. We can put different catch blocks for a single try block. This allows us to provide handling code specific to the exception. The exceptions we handle must be ordered from specific exceptions to general exceptions. The reason is Java will try to match the exception class from top to bottom. As soon as Java hits an exception it matches, it stops looking. So if we put exception as a first class like this, it doesn't matter if there's a more specific exception class later. Exception is a superclass, so this catch applies to exception in any subtype, which is everything. Java will only run one catch block per exception. Catching the exception is just bad practice. The reason is, we're telling Java this code handles this exception type. If we use the exception superclass, that means we're saying our code handles any error that can happen. There are not many cases where that's true. It's not Pokemon. We don't want to catch them all. Usually, we'd want to recover from a file not found differently than an error from parsing. It's very important we put our application back into a runnable state after catching exceptions. When we catch an exception, our catch block is run, and then the very next line of code is executed. So if we don't completely recover from whatever problem threw the exception, we're just going to create more problems. There are three things we might see in code we're maintaining. The first is a blank catch block. This hides the problem as if it never happened. It's saying, try this code, and if it fails, ignore the problem and hope no one notices. What almost always happens in our application is now it's in an invalid state, and something bad will happen again later down the road in a completely different location. This makes the problem very hard to diagnose and fix. Don't ever do it. If you don't know how to handle the exception, specify the requirement for the calling class to handle it. The next worst thing is, some developers will say, hey, since I can't have a blank catch block, I'll add a log message. Or worse, write a message to the console. That's the same thing as a blank catch block. In this case, we're writing a note that no one's going to see, and then putting the application in a state where something bad can happen again later on. Again, if you don't know how to handle the exception, specify the requirement for the calling class to handle it. Finally, we might see code like this. This is called catching and throwing an exception. The problem is, we're losing the stack trace. The exception in our try block is handled, and then we're throwing a new exception with the stack trace starting from here. If you want to log a message and then rethrow an exception, this is how you do it. Just use the keyword throw with the same exception object. This will preserve the stack trace.
And that's a whirlwind tour of Java exceptions. In the next video, we'll look at diagnosing common exceptions and how to fix them. Put any questions you have in the comments below. Liking the video helps me know what I'm doing right. So if you like the video, you know what to do. And with that, I'll see you in the next tutorial.